Agus, your camera is still on.
Oh, sorry.
It's okay. Just want to tell you. Okay. Hello back, everybody. This week for this year's last Actinobase eSeminar. Our guest today is Dr. Kai Blin from the Danish Technical University. Just to shortly introduce him, did his diploma in the group of Oliver Kohlbacher at the University of Tübingen, and then switched for his PhD to the group of Tilman Weber. And after that, he went for a short while, he went to the Max Planck Institute in Cologne for his postdoctoral studies, and then he switched to the Danish Technical University, again under Professor Tilman Weber, where he is working to this day. And he is today going to talk to us about anti-smash. And since a lot of you seem to have submitted some very nice questions, I guess this will be a very productive meeting today. So, Kai, the stage is all yours.
Thanks. Okay, so welcome everybody. So I decided to try and do like a different talk to what I usually do when I go and talk about anti-smash conferences. And today I'm going to tell you everything you wanted to know about anti-smash, but were afraid to ask, or rather, were not afraid to ask, because this is basically answering a couple of questions that people submitted in a Google form that we sent around a couple of weeks ago. So thanks for participating there. So quick thing about myself, if I can get my slides to advance there. I have a master's level education in bioinformatics, as Oliver already said. Back in Oliver Kohlbacher's group, I did my PhD in microbiology, but sort of computational microbiology. I mainly did genome mining there. Extracurricular wise, I have about 16 years of experience in software engineering. So this is where a lot of my software development background comes from. And together with Manix Middamer, who is now a professor at Wageningen University in the Netherlands, I'm the co-creator of AntiSmash, like almost 11 years ago now. Some short facts about AntiSmash and like a couple of the related services that are running here in Denmark at DTU Biosustain. We've processed a bit over 1 million jobs since we launched the public web service in 2011. The anti-smash and related papers have accumulated over 6,500 citations, so people are using this quite a lot. All the code you can find on GitHub, everything is available via Bioconda, and there's also Docker containers. The whole show is running on 8 servers that we're hosting at the D2 Riese facility with almost 800 CPU cores, around 3 terabytes of RAM, and 35-ish terabytes of storage. So just a quick thing sort of about who this talk is for, really. So when I posted the sent me some anti-smash questions questionnaire, I also asked a bit about how long have people been using anti-smash. And as you can see, so I would say about half of our users have been using anti-smash for 2 years or less, then and the rest sort of for more than that. So I would say half of the people who are now using anti-smash have been using anti-smash for only a relatively short while, which is explained by the fact that most of the people who are using anti-smash these days are either grad students or postdocs. So probably they've started using anti-smash for a particular project they're on and sort of don't necessarily have prior experience. Now, going to the questions. So people submitted a lot of great questions, and it's in fact there were too many questions to tackle today. There's really no way for me to answer all of them. I will sort of take the ones that are the highlights that were asked most often and that I felt made most sense to answer. I want to highlight one question that basically merits like a whole talk of its own. And this was asking if I could give a walkthrough of how I use anti-smash when I look at a new genome, sort of what steps I do every time, what do I look at, what steps are most useful. And as I said, right, this is like a whole talk all by itself. So I decided that one I'll turn into a video tutorial or maybe multiple video tutorials doing this for multiple genomes, because it's really hard to sort of find a genome that has all of the features that might be interesting and that I might focus on and talk about. So this is going to be a separate video. I'll be posting that as soon as I get around to record these. Okay, so just so we're on the same page, and also because some people have asked sort of how does the anti-smash workflow even look like? Basically, you start with a microbial genome sequence. Hang on, let me just get a laser pointer here. So basically, we start with either a bacterial. So this applies for bacterial sequences in anti-smash, and fungi smash is really the same thing with a couple of different defaults. So you start with a genome sequence that hopefully already has gene annotations. And then anti-smash goes ahead and does a couple of rule-based cluster detection steps. Then also it identifies NRPS and PKS modules, and then runs gene functionality annotations using these secondary metabolite clusters of orthologous groups collection. And so that's run by default. And then depending on the options that you choose when you start anti-smash, there's a couple of extra features that can run. So we can do gene finding if we have to. We can load some external annotations. We can do PFAM annotations for the regions that we've identified. We can do TigerFAM annotations. And if you have a fungal genome, you can also run border prediction using the Cassis algorithm. So this only works for fungi. I'll talk a bit more about this later, so I will not spend too much time on it right now. Then sort of after the detection steps are done, a number of analyses run, and you can roughly split them in two different types, right? There's a type dependent. So the type dependent analyses only run on specific types of secondary metabolite gene clusters. So, I mean, they're NRPS, PKS monomer prediction only run on NRPSs and type 1 PKSs. The PKS type 2 annotations only run on type 2 PKSs. And like for all these RIPs down here, so lantipeptides, thiopeptides, actipeptides, and lasopeptides, we have some cluster-specific annotations. And like only on RIPs, we run the RE Finder plugin. And there's some type-independent analysis that run on pretty much everything, right? So every time we find a region of interest, we can throw these type independent analyses on it. And this is cluster blast, known cluster blast, and subcluster blast, as well as cluster compare. And sort of I'll talk a bit about cluster blast, known cluster blast, and cluster compare a bit later. But there's also the TTA codon annotation, active site finder, drawing SM-Coq trees if you want to, and PFAM to go, and some other annotations. And last but not least, sort of the last step in the anti-smash workflow is then generating an HTML output, some JSON annotations. And like for the anti-smash web service, there's also a small REST API that third-party tools can use. So for example, ARTS, BigFam, and CrispyWeb are three tools that can go and fetch anti-smash results. If you have run an anti-smash job on the anti-smash web service, and you now want to analyze the genome further in ARTS or BigFam or so, you can go ahead and directly download anti-smash annotated results from there, or like the service will go and do that. So you don't have to download your results and then upload it to the other thing. Okay, so now the most common question in the set is how does anti-smash detect gene clusters? And also, sort of while we're at this, I'll answer on how does anti-smash determine gene cluster borders, because that was sort of like the second most popular question. So basically, if you like remember back in the flowchart, we do a rule-based cluster prediction. And I've taken an example rule down here. And this is like how it's determined in, or like how it's defined in the anti-smash source code. So there is a file that contains these relatively structured but still very human readable rules. So basically we say like the rule for NRPS clusters annotates like NRPS type clusters. So for NRPS is not like super exciting, but for example, we have all of these different PKS rules and they all annotate category PKS. And there's a comment because there's so many types of clusters now. I think we have 71 now that I basically, this is just for myself so I can remember which type of cluster this abbreviation goes to. And then the important parts here are we define a cutoff. This is how far we go from like one gene that we have identified to the next one in order to extend the region. We have a neighborhood setting that tells us like how much around the identified genes we want to display on the website. And this is both in kilobase pairs. And then last but not least, we have the actual rule that defines how we identify a cluster. So like basically the rule says we need like a CDS that contains a condensation domain and either an AMP binding or an AOX type of domain. Now, just to sort of go a bit more into detail on how this works, is basically as the first step, we go through and we take these profiles that are profile hidden Markov models. You don't need to fully understand how these work. So basically, they are just mathematical representations of multiple sequence alignments of interesting domains that we want to identify. And we go and we search the whole genome with this set of profiles, and we go and annotate our protein domains, right? And once we've done that, we're ready for the next step, which is let's find clusters based on the rules. And you've seen I've picked some genes at random that have a couple of domains annotated. And now let's go and apply one of the rules that we have to this. So you can see, right, our rule says we want to find a CDS. So we look at this gene by gene. And that gene needs to contain, well, that gene product technically needs to contain condensation domains and AMP binding or AOX domains. So if we do this for the first gene here, we see that there's a bunch of condensation domains. So like this part of the rule matches, and there's a bunch of AMP binding domains. So this part of the rule matches as well. So we can say like this gene is part of an NRPS protocluster. Now we repeat the same thing for the next gene. So again, we look at this and say like, okay, so there's a bunch of condensation domains. There's a bunch of adenylation domains. So this also is an NRPS. And once more, we find a bunch of condensation domains and we find a bunch of AMP binding domains. So this is also an NRPS. So this we keep doing until we stop finding anything, and then still we keep going for as many kilobases as our cutoff said. So if we go back to the rule, right, we now try to expand the cluster and find more genes that might belong to it until we hit like cutoff KB in like upstream and downstream directions. And then we take the neighborhood and say like, this is the surrounding of the core cluster that we want to show. And we annotate something that if you sort of have seen anti-smash results before, like the core genes that we've identified that hit the rule are sort of in dark red down here. And up there, sort of they are the dark part of the box that says this is part of an NRPS protocluster. And then everything 20 KB upstream and 20 KB downstream is what is in the neighborhood. And this is sort of defined so we can catch all of the tailoring enzymes and everything else that might be involved in the cluster, regulatory enzymes, transporters and whatnot, that sort of don't hit our, this is the core cluster rule. As the next step, we go back in and say, like in this particular case, this is an NRPS cluster. So we go in and take a different set of profiles to annotate NRPS and PKS domains. So you can see that unlike before, we only had the condensation and adenylation domain, we now also have the PCP domains, epimerization domains, and like thioesterases, and like anything else that might be in an NRPS or PKS, we also try to annotate at this step. And then last but not least, we go and annotate gene functions based on our secondary metabolite clusters of orthologous groups. And we also go and color in the cluster like this. So basically going from like no annotation whatsoever to an annotation where we say like, this is the core, then everything in bright red is potentially sort of also biosynthetic. So this might be tailoring enzymes or other things. Everything in blue is transport related. Everything in green is regulatory functions. So this is again based on these clusters of orthologous groups that are basically just annotated based on, we find these a lot in other secondary metabolite gene clusters. Okay, so next thing people asked about is how do cluster comparison work? And this is a tricky topic. And like the true answer is, I don't really know, right? I mean, we do some cluster comparisons in anti-smash, and like I know how these work, but none of these are perfect. So I mean, there's really no good method that I'm aware of to really nicely compare, like, is this cluster, like how similar is this gene cluster to this gene cluster? There's really sort of, we haven't come up with a way yet, and I haven't seen anybody else come up with anything that works really well either. But let's talk about what we currently can do in anti-smash. So first is Cluster Blast. Cluster Blast has been around since we published anti-smash. It's run on a database of anti-smash results for publicly available genomes. So at the moment, this is the current anti-smash database. And sort of the similarity score, or like how similar the cluster that we're just looking at is to clusters in the database, is calculated based on this formula down here. So it's basically just a couple of scores that add up. So like the number of gene hits, the number of core gene hits. So the core genes, again, are the ones that we hit by the rules, and like the other genes are just the ones around. And then like how many gene pairs do we have between the query cluster and the subject clusters, where there's synteny between two genes. So they're basically arranged in the same way. And then we have the same idea again, but for core genes, based on the idea that core genes are more important than any genes or any of the other genes. So basically we count these twice, both for the hits and for the synteny part. And then there's an extra core gene bonus that where we get like a flat extra 3 points for every time we actually have a good match between like a core gene in the query and a core gene in the subject. And with this sort of, we come up with a pretty decent way of saying like, okay, this is a similar cluster. The only part where this breaks down, and this is, I think, the biggest challenge for cluster comparisons, is in multimodal clusters. So if you have NRPSs or PKSs, because we use BLAST, or I mean like Diamond these days, but I mean like a BLAST-like tool, 5 modules and 8 modules look completely the same for BLAST, right? So NRPS looks like every other NRPS for BLAST, really. And this is a bit of a challenge. Okay, so known cluster BLAST is basically exactly the same thing as cluster BLAST, but instead of using the anti-smash database as the data set, we use the MIBIG database, which is a database, like a manually curated database of clusters where sort of we know that this cluster is producing a given compound, and there's some extra publication annotations and maybe some extra information available on this. So this is like the gold standard of known gene clusters. So instead of like anything that looks like something else anti-smash picks up that you get from cluster blast, known cluster blast is like, we really know like this is this cluster, right? The difference of course is that the anti-smash database that we use for cluster blast contains 25,000 genomes with like 150,000 clusters. And there's roughly 2,000 entries in MIBig. So I think both methods have their value, depending on sort of how much you want to focus on known stuff versus is there anything else similar in the public NCBI datasets. Now, a new thing, like the new kid on the block for cluster comparisons, is our attempt of improving or sort of like trying to work around some of these issues that we've noticed with Cluster Blast. So in Antismesh 6, we launched the cluster compare for MIBig, sort of the competitor for known Cluster Blast. So we also run the database of MIBig entries, but the score is calculated differently. So basically what we're doing is we're calculating a geometric mean value of a score for the gene hits that is pretty similar to what Cluster Blast does. And we scale that from 0 to 1, where 1 sort of is set to be like the highest score any of our comparisons gave for that particular gene. Then we give a synthony score, where again, we're trying to score things that where genes are in the same order, higher than clusters where genes are all present, but they're sort of mixed up. The idea being that it might still be functionally the same, but is less similar than one where also all of the genes are in the same order. And again, we scale this from 0 to 1. And then we have a component score, meaning that if there's any SMCOC annotations, or if in cases for NRPSs and PKSs, there's modules, we really want like the modules to match as well. So basically, if you have a 5-module NRPS and another 5-module NRPS, and all of the substrates are predicted to be the same, this score is higher than like a 5-module NRPS against a 3-module NRPS or a 7-module NRPS, because the number of clusters is not the same. And this obviously only applies if there are components that we can look at. So like if we have gene clusters where like none of our components actually trigger, this is basically just flat out set to 1. But like the component score, in my opinion, is the part where we're trying to sort of be smarter than Cluster Blast. But this is challenging for some reason. So basically, a lot of the MIBig annotations are still made by Antismesh 5 at this point. And so if we compare this to Antismesh 6 results, the components that we annotate might be different. So this might give us like a score depreciation, despite the fact that the cluster actually should be the same, just because our annotation versions are a bit different. So there's some challenges to that. This is also the reason why there's no cluster compare for the Antismesh database yet, because that makes things even more difficult in terms of a region might contain multiple clusters, right? Whereas in MIBig, we know that there's only a single cluster. So some of the problems there are a bit more simple. But I'm hopeful that we might have a cluster compare version for the Antismesh database for Antismesh 7. Now, just to give an idea of how the results look like. So this is Cluster Blast for the cluster that we've just detected previously. And you can see that sort of for our query sequence, there's a bunch of matches that are sort of almost identical, right? So you would expect these all to be very similar compounds. You can see that there's some wonkiness in some of these, and I would go ahead and personally, I just blame that on funky like frame shifts in sequencing maybe here. And you see that sort of down towards the bottom, the similarity tends to drop off. And like the one down here on the bottom, there's really nothing that is super similar to the cluster that we're looking at. So that's just in there because like it's set up to always show 10 hits. I wouldn't trust that one a bit. And even though, I mean, like you can see it still says like 29% similarity, but this must be based on just a handful of the tailoring enzymes. For known Cluster Blast, again, you see the same, but like the annotation might be a bit more useful, right? You see that we get like a really nice similarity to the CDA cluster. And the reason for that is that this was the CDA cluster that I used for the annotation. So one of the well-known metabolites from Streptomyces cellulare A32. And then you see that there's hits for some other lipopeptides. And then sort of we run into this problem that like all of the hits down here still look kind of reasonable in if you look at sort of how much of the cluster is also magenta, right? But it's really just like this is an NRPS and this is an NRPS. And for BLAST, it's like, yeah, that's the same thing, right? So, I mean, we see like 18% similarity between like bleomycin, which is a glycopeptide, and CDA. And I mean, if you look at this, they're nothing alike. I mean, apart from both being NRPS products. For cluster compare MIBIG, things look a bit different. So we are still doing like the top 10 hits, but we are only showing pairwise alignments. And what that allows us is that we can sort of start drawing these lines of like, this gene is similar to this, and so on and so on. So rather than having this random color that we have in cluster BLAST, where sort of similar genes have similar colors, we're really just keeping the original annotation with all of the information that carries from anti-smash, and we're just drawing a line saying like this is similar to this one, right? So I mean, again, here in this case, it's not no big surprise that obviously these clusters are the same. So there's some extra genes downstream that we miss due to the way our, oh, we'll just take 20 kb upstream, 20 kb downstream logic works. And there's an extra gene that we include that's not part of the annotated cluster, again, because of the cutoffs. So you can see that sort of, this is a pretty good hit. It's not perfect because the anti-smash annotation is not perfect. Okay. And last is sort of my catch-all, because people were asking about sort of what features beyond the basics are there in anti-smash. And when I sat down to build the slide, I realized it's there's some. So I'll go ahead and mention all of these here, and then I'll look into some of these in a bit more detail, just to get an idea what's going on. So yeah, I mean, I'm not sure I'd call this an advanced feature, but it's sort of there on top of what I discussed previously. So if you happen to upload a FASTA file to anti-smash, we run gene finding. And the gene finder we use for prokaryotic genomes is Prodigal. That's pretty decent. So you can use that in a pinch. For fungal sequences, we use Glimmer HMM, and that's pretty garbage. It's just like the only gene finder for fungi that we could find that basically is performing on a similar level for all of the different fungi that you can put in without having any extra configuration. Anything else that's sort of more fancy in terms of fungal gene finders, you always need to tell it what kind of fungus you're running. And I just couldn't figure out a good way of entering this information in anti-smash. So really, if you have a fungal genome, please like run a proper gene finder before submitting to anti-smash, because the stuff that anti-smash will annotate into your fungal genome, yeah, it's not that great. So yeah, there's that. Oh, and one thing that I know also trips up people occasionally, we only run gene finding if you upload a FASTA file. If you upload a GenBank file that has no gene annotations in it, anti-smash will just abort saying like, oh, there's no genes. And because you uploaded a GenBank file, it will assume that like you know which genes are there. So if there's no genes annotated for a contig, there's no genes in the contig, right? So this is for the website. If you run it locally, I think you can always force a gene finder to be used. But sort of on the website, if you run this and you upload a GenBank file without any gene annotations, anti-smash will just not run on it because it didn't find any genes. Starting in the last version, we support running external tools for doing cluster annotations. I usually call this sideloading, and I'll talk about this in a bit more detail later. As I mentioned before, if you have a fungal genome, you can do some cluster border predictions using the Cassis tool. I'll also talk about this in a bit more detail. Then yeah, cluster BLAST, known cluster BLAST, and subcluster BLAST are advanced features. I've already talked about two of the three. Subcluster Blast, again, is pretty much the same as Cluster Blast, but the database is precursor supply subclusters. So yeah, if you have glycosylated compounds and those use any funky sugars, chances are if the sugars are in your cluster, Subcluster Blast might pick them up. Yeah, Cluster Compare, we've also talked about already. We can do PFAM annotations. We can take these PFAM annotations and translate the PFAM hits that we got to GO terms. So you get some idea of the functional background there using the PFAM to go list. We can do TigerFAM annotations. They are sort of a bit more tailored, like the Tiger families profiles that are a bit more tailored to secondary metabolite production. For genomes, where this makes sense. So I think if the GC content is above 65% or so, we run a TTA codon detection. This is mainly because in streptomycetes, TTA codons have a regulatory function. That's not necessarily true for everything that has a high GC content, but it's a super cheap analysis to run. So we basically always run it if the GC content looks like it makes sense. And there's Active Site Finder, which is a nice little tool that for some enzymes can find the active site and look into the active site to see if there's any mutations in there that might mean that a specific enzyme is inactive. So this was like the general features, and then sort of on the type specific ones, we can do NRPS and PKS monomer predictions. We're going to have a quick look at NRPS monomer predictions. We can do a classification of type 2 polyketides. And then again, as mentioned before, for lantipeptides, thiopeptides, sactipeptides, and lasopeptides, we can do some cluster-specific annotations as well. And for all of the RIPs that we can pick up, we run the RAE Finder tool. Okay, so let's have a quick look at site loading. So site loading is new in AntiSmash 6. And we've initially built these together with the DeepBGC developers who have like this deep learning bisynthetic gene cluster prediction tool. And DeepBGC only outputs a bunch of tables of the stuff that it found. And we were in contact with the developers there trying to see if we could like integrate some of their results in the AntiSmash output to get like a nice web output for this. And basically, what we've built is a JSON format. So basically, DeepBGC can generate this file that you can load into AntiSmash, and then AntiSmash will show the DeepBGC results alongside its own results. And the details on how the JSON file needs to look like, if you have another tool that can annotate gene clusters, is on the AntiSmash docs page. I've put a quick example on how this looks. So it's pretty generic, right? So basically have some information about the tool that we can display. And you can sort of put some configuration in that you've used. So basically when you later look at the AntiSmash results, you can sort of figure out which parameters you ran the other tool with. And then you basically need to go in and say like, for like the record with this ID, we found like these subregions or these protoclusters, and then these get annotated like regions or protoclusters that AntiSmash found itself. So this is more of an advanced feature in the way that most people will not be using this, but if you have another tool that you want to sort of marry with AntiSmash that can also predict gene clusters, site loading is the way to go. Now, border prediction is a challenging issue, right? So as mentioned before, and let me restate that because this is important, is AntiSmash really has no good idea on how borders look like. We have like empirical data on like most of these gene clusters. If we like extend it by that many kilobases upstream and downstream, we pick up all of the tailoring enzymes that we care about. And occasionally when we find clusters where we clearly miss some of the important tailoring enzymes, we basically just bump the numbers and the next release will sort of include a bit more upstream and downstream. And I would say very frequently, these cutoffs are too big. So the region that we show you will contain the cluster, but will also contain some genes that sort of don't belong to the cluster. And it's really up to you as the user and the expert for the cluster to figure out which is which. But if you work on fungi, you're in luck, because Thomas Wolf, back in 2016, built this brilliant tool called Cassis that we also have, like, he integrated into Antismash back in Antismash 4, I think. And that basically looks at the 5' UTRs of core genes that Antismash identified, and then tries to find, like, motifs that are similar in the 5' UTRs of nearby genes. So basically the idea is that there should be a promoter region in front of the core gene, and that same promoter region should also exist in front of the other genes that belong to the cluster. And that way you can identify sort of which genes belong to the cluster. And this, of course, only works in fungi, because in bacteria you have operons and promoters are harder to identify, and all of these extra issues. But in fungi, it works really nice. So you can see that this then generates annotation like this, where sort of like the dark red are the core genes that we have identified. And then Cassis realized, okay, but like this gene here and that gene downstream, they still have the same promoter. So those are part of the gene cluster as well. So this gives a bit better idea of what you're looking at. Now, for NRPS monomer prediction, we're using NRPS predictor, a tool that Mark Rottig published, like the second version of, back in 2011. So this is already getting a bit old. We're currently working on like an updated data set that we can use to train a new predictor, but this is still sort of ongoing project, and NRPS predictor 2 works relatively fine. So we're still using that. It's been an anti-smash since the start. And what it basically does is it looks at the residues in the NRPS adenylation domain active site. So it ignores everything else around this, but it sort of picks out, like, these residues are part of the active site. And then it does a classification on what the substrate might be that fits into this active site. And it predicts the loaded substrate based on both the Stachelhaus code, which is really sort of an old method that's just a lookup table of known active sites. And we also have a machine learning algorithm that is sort of a bit more flexible and also can cover stuff that's not covered by the Stachelhaus code. And that performs a bit better for things where we don't have an exact match to the table. I'm not going to into details on how the machine learning part works, because then I'll be here for another hour, and let's not go there. But I mean, basically, these are the two methods we use for monomer predictions. They tend to work pretty well, I would say. Again, if you're on fungi, back in 2011, there were only a handful of fungal sequences we could train on, so the prediction there is less good. If you work on cyanobacteria, it looks like the annihilation domain active sites look a bit different there. So also the predictions are not too great. In streptomycetes, I would say they're pretty decent. So for PKS type 2 annotations, I had a student, Rasmus Wilbron, who in 2019 did a big analysis of published type 2 PKS clusters, and then built quite a number of profiles to predict, like, type 2 PKS starter units, how many elongation steps are happening in this iterative synthesis, which tailoring enzymes are present, and which cyclases are present, if I sort of pull these out from the other tailoring enzymes. And then, based on how many elongation steps happen and which cyclases are present, it also can go and predict a product class for the cluster. So that really gives you a pretty good idea of what type of what kind of type 2 PKS you're dealing with. And because that also was a question, and I felt that I had a quick slide I could slip in on this, is sort of just as a quick overview for, like, new features in Antismash 6. If we go and look at the workflow and sort of how new features distribute over that, there's 71 different cluster types supported in Antismash 6 now. as a new feature in PKS and NRPS analysis, we not only detect the domains, but we also detect modules and draw them in our output. We can load external annotations. Already talked about that. I already talked about cluster compare. We improved a lot on sort of how we do RIP annotations, and we added our eFinder. And the TigerFams annotation also is a new feature in Antismesh 6. Now, I want to finish up by giving a sneak peek to what's currently happening in Antismesh development. So this is not everything that's happening, but one cool thing that also already looks pretty nice on a slide, and that's we're trying to switch to a new way of drawing NRPS and PKS domain bubble graphs. So instead of the old way that I actually haven't really shown you in this talk, but we're going to try and draw these more the way you would see these in publications. So this is the Curamycin gene cluster, and you can see this like a hybrid trans-AT PKS and NRPS cluster, and you see sort of that the PKS sort of goes and bunches up for all of these extra modification enzymes in the domains, and the NRPSs are pretty straightforward, right? And so I have a meeting with one of Marnix Medema's PhD students and one of her master students next week. We can also add like proper spaghetti diagrams. So basically attaching our predicted loaded monomers to these, and then sort of have something that's almost publication ready from the anti-smash predictions. So I'm really excited about that and just wanted to show this off. And so I've mentioned Marnix a couple of times. Sort of Marnix and I, 11 years ago, started building the first version of anti-smash, and it's been a fun ride ever since. And Marnix also still very active in the whole anti-smash and related things. So I think he's currently still running today's MIBIG annotation event, where a lot of people are coming together to add new clusters to MIBIG. Tim Anweber, who's been my sort of unofficial PhD supervisor and also my current boss, who's giving me a lot of freedom to work on anti-smash and all of the related stuff. And of course, also a big shout out to Simon Shaw, who's the software engineer in my group, who's done a lot of the heavy lifting in anti-smash 5 and onwards. Basically, he was behind the anti-smash 5 rewrite that made anti-smash so much faster than it used to be. And also sort of keeps me on my toes in terms of software quality. And last but not least, sort of thanks to the Novo Nordisk Foundation for funding the whole show for all of these years, for servers, Simon's and my position and everything. And with that, thanks. And I think if people have asked questions on Twitter, I guess we still might have some time to go through these. I'm not sure. I mean, like, this was a answer all the questions talk. I'm not sure if there were many questions.
Thanks a lot, Kai. That was also the idea here. But to the audience still listening, you now, of course, still have maybe time for a really burning question that might not have been already answered or that came up. I think we'll just wait for a second here. If there won't come any, if no questions come up, then me and the rest of the seminar team will take the time to thank you, the audience. But no, it doesn't seem like there is anything. I guess there will also always be the chance to contact Kai, right?
You can. As mentioned, you can find me on Twitter. I just like switched to the first slide. So I'm on Twitter at Kai Blin. And you can also email me. You can use the contact form on the Antismash website if you have any questions about Antismash. Simon and I are very happy to answer questions there. And you'll find a way. And as I said, there were a couple of questions that, especially the one on sort of what's the workflow and sort of actually using this to look at new genomes, that was sort of too extensive to answer here, but I'm hoping to get a video or three out of this soonish.
All right. Cool. In this case, people enjoyed your talk, but no questions anymore. The question is, there's one question coming up, where you will post your video tutorials. Will you post them on YouTube or?
Yeah, so these will be on YouTube. I sort of just 2 days ago created a YouTube channel for Antismesh, so there's nothing on it yet. I'll post that on Twitter for sure, and I might put like a news box thing on the Antismesh website, because I think more people will find that than Twitter.
Okay. In this case, thank you. Really looking forward to your spaghetti diagrams. Sounds nice.
Yeah, so am I. I mean, like that's not my work. That's Barbara and her PhD student. Her master student. She's the PhD student.
Yeah, well, it will be on the user side. It will just be a nice thing, probably. So
I'm absolutely hyped about this. So I mean, like already the bubble graphs that Simon built are super awesome and sort of. We don't have a version with it like in yet, but I'm hoping that we'll have a sort of preview on our development website soonish. But this is a really fresh off the press and it's not even dry yet.
It would have been my main question actually, what your next steps will be. But in this case, we will just be surprised what comes out. Really cool tool. I'm pretty sure everybody looking here and many more have been so thankful for the existence of Antismesh. So really hyped to see what's coming next. Okay, thank you, Kai.
Great, thanks.
So now, since, as I already told you, this is the last seminar for this week, me and the rest of the committee who are coming up right now, somebody has a bird nearby. Okay. So now we as the committee would really like to thank you, the audience, the ones online right now, and also the ones watching this video in the future and who have watched these videos, for the great discussions we were allowed to have here, and just for showing all of this around, hopefully to your colleagues. For the continuation of this format, I guess we will see, since with the pandemics seeming to slow down a little bit, hopefully we will be able next year to see our colleagues in person again. But in any case, I guess we will see if we will just distribute a poll or something like this for your opinions on if you would like to have a format like this next year again, maybe every year, we will see. And we will then do our best to keep the committee and with this, the ActinoBase seminar itself alive. So I guess everything being said, again, of course, also before I forget it, thanks to all the speakers who actually made this possible in the first place. And with this, I would say goodbye to you. As I already said, we will try to have a poll or anything. So we will get your opinions on if you like the format, also maybe if you have any ideas how we could improve it, and we'll distribute it to the general email list we have. And also we will see maybe on Twitter or something. We have to work this out. So in this case, bye-bye from me, maybe guys from you as well.
No, just to say thank you all.
Yeah, thank you for watching.
Thank you.
It's great. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for tuning in.
Cool.